Hey guys, I'm Nick Schiffer. I own a custom home building company here in Boston called NS Builders, and I'm at our 45 White Oak project. And today I got a special guest. Matt Reisinger is here to walk through the project, and we're gonna talk about high performance and the details that he noticed here at our build. You came here to talk about windows, and you asked me a bunch of questions on the facade and the cladding, and it's brick cladding, but you said something that it was a 500 year.
So another Boston guy that I've been following for years, sorry for the lawnmower noise, y'all. Joe Stiebrick,
That's winter in Boston.
That's winter in Boston. Joe Stiebrick wrote this paper like 15 years ago it's a concept he said he stole from some of the greats that says, what is the perfect wall? And could we build a house that would last 500 years? Mm-hmm. And so I've kind of changed that phrasing to Monopoly framing just because I like the way it makes sense that this kind of looks like a big Monopoly piece.
Yeah.
Not the new plastic Monopoly pieces that have an overhang, the old wooden ones from the 50s. So if you look at this house, Nick, it looks like a big Monopoly piece, which is cool architecturally, but what it gives you from a building science perspective is you're able to go straight up the wall with your WRB and your insulation and intersect your roof with all those tricky details made much, much easier. And so this house with several thick inches of insulation is just like putting a blanket or a coat on in cold weather.
Right.
So you've got this perfect wall that Joe says lasts 500 years, super high performance construction. But what gets me excited is you put a facade that's gonna last 500 years as well.
Yeah,
this isn't asphalt shingles and some fiber cement that you're gonna be replacing in 50 years.
It's funny how many comments we've got, like, why not just do fiber cement? Why not just do metal? And the story behind the brick was Vincent from Impossible was like, I have this crazy idea. And he pitched to me this cladding. He never showed me what his backup plan was. He told me he had one, but I was like, I love it. Like, I know this product, you know, Vince Van Dusen did a project in the Hamptons with it. Let's do it. It was only until we were installing it where we realized there's no mortar and it simply hangs on the side of the building. And in our case, we did it up on the roof as well. So it's monolithic material and it requires no maintenance.
Fabulous.
500 year material on top of a wall system that incredibly high performance, but also will last a tremendous amount of time.
Yeah, pretty fabulous. That is a detail that you don't see very often. In fact, this is the first time I've seen a perfect wall house that I legitimately think, oh yeah, a couple hundred years from now, you'll come back and it'll pretty much look the same.
So winter in Boston was obviously too loud. I don't know why, they're blowing leaves that are frozen on the ground.
And they started like the second we started the video.
I was like, hey Matt, and they were like, whoop. So we moved, we're out front.
We're not podcasting, we're not in the studio.
We're not in the studio. So you came out here to see the windows. You're here with EAS.
Yep.
They helped us with the windows. Patrick graciously has let everyone know that these are the most expensive and crazy windows he's ever done.
Yes.
In terms of white oak. I love that. But he had communicated something that I don't know if I had heard before, but how they don't require maintenance for 50 plus years.
Yeah.
I think it's really important to call attention to that because it's not that they will need to be replaced or fixed or anything. It's just maintenance.
Yeah, just caulking and touch up.
Yeah, just
not necessary for 50 years.
From us, we do post-construction. We're here all the time. We're making sure the house is staying in great shape. You made a comment about the 500 year wall. I don't even approach it high performance mindset. Like, it's funny because I get dubbed a high performance builder. I just want to build a good house.
You're the modern craftsman.
The modern
craftsman. You're all about craftsmanship. Yeah.
But you looked at it from a building science perspective and you said, this is 500 years.
From the very beginning, I saw you building this house and I thought, this is a beautiful example of Monopoly framing. Mm. You're utilizing Joe's concept, which is basically, let's frame the wall so when we go up, there's nothing that impedes our water, air, vapor, or thermal barrier from being consistent from the wall to the roof line. So that Monopoly framing is 100% consistent. We've got really airtight, watertight, and now, what you've done that I've never seen before in this house is you put a cladding system on the outside that could also legitimately last 500 years.
Yeah, it's a masonry shingle. And when you think masonry, typically you think of repointing in the mortar over time, but there's no mortar. It's completely dry laid.
That's right.
It is suspended on a wood batten system. An issue that comes up is, oh, well, it's wood. It will eventually rot. It's like, it's got 3 inches of airspace. It is designed to breathe and drain. And that's part of why we do that.
And you've also treated your framing on the inside the same way as you've treated your dining room table. And that's the thing that really gets me excited about this. You know, in Europe, they've got 500-year-old houses that are masonry, double-wide masonry, all stone. Mm-hmm. But if you go to Japan, you can see structures that are 1,000 years old that are wood.
Yeah.
And so if we keep wood dry and we keep it air-conditioned and we keep the humidity consistent, which everything inboard of your WRB on this house is,
right,
now it could last 500 years. There's maybe it'll move a little bit,
sure,
with some natural swelling and shrinking, but not much. Mm-hmm. And so this house legitimately could be here 500 years from now.
That's how we should be building. I asked someone recently and they were, I was like, how long do you expect the home to last? They're like, I don't know, 50 years, 75. Like, that's such a small window of time.
I know.
The fact that you could build a home when you're born and it be torn down by the time you're gone, it's like that. We should be building for way longer than that.
So what I want your audience to think about from this house, though, this is obviously not an affordable house, right? I didn't get gigged on my YouTube channel about this.
To some people, it's affordable.
It's not affordable for you or I or any of the craftsmen working here, right? I get this comment all the time.
Yeah.
But what I want people to think of is, Cadillac was the first person to put airbags in, and now your crappiest Kia has airbags, right? So take what you're learning from Nick on this project and utilize that in your affordable projects. And you know what? I'm seeing that more and more. Like, I visited an affordable project built to like a $200,000 house that was a Monopoly framed house. Mm-hmm. And that builder was taking the concepts that he learned from us and from other building science teachers and doing it in an affordable way. The thing I want to learn from, and I want to think about how to do this, is how do I take this cladding system and do a similarly super bomber cladding that needs no maintenance for decades and decades? The other thing that's crazy about this cladding, Nick, is you could take this off remodel and reuse it.
Yeah.
You know, when I demoed my house, I piled the brick, my guys chipped the mortar out and I relayed it. This could be done the same with even less work, frankly.
You're unscrewing it from
You're unscrewing it, you're stacking it. We can add an addition onto this house in 100 years and we could put it right back on. That's pretty fabulous.
So from the outside, we talk about the enduring aspect of it, right? Mm-hmm. How long this will last and the performance it's been built. But part of that performance is the mechanical.
Yep.
Like, we talk about the windows, but mechanical is a big aspect of this. And
for sure.
Truthfully, you were like, I need to see the mechanical room. So is it only fair that we go down to the mechanical
room? Let's go down to the mechanical room. Right, that's my favorite room in the house.
Let's do that.
All right, let's do it.
So arguably one of the most expensive rooms in the house, mainly because the entire location of this was 100% ledge.
Well, this is an expensive room to bring out all that rock, wasn't it?
Yes.
But well worth it.
Yeah. Mechanically, I'm cutting you off because this is my video.
Oh, I love this. I love this. This is so good. I want to talk. I'm sorry.
High performance windows, triple pane glass throughout the whole house, 11 to 18 inches of insulation, depending on where you're looking at the envelope. We heat and cool the whole house with Mitsubishi Hyperheats. Two outdoor units feed the distribution boxes. Those distribution boxes feed individual indoor units, air handlers, whatever you want to call them. You can heat and cool off the same heat pump.
That's amazing.
Per unit, depending on how you want it.
By the way, Hyperheat works down to what temperature? Do you know? -5.
I thought it was -15.
It'll still get heat out at -15.
Oh, hot.
Full heat down to -5.
Yes. Yeah.
So even if it's -5 out, you have full heating capacity.
Right.
Here.
It's the efficiency. You start losing efficiency.
That's right.
Yeah. Which I think is actually important to note, where it's like, well, what happens if it's, -6? It's like, it doesn't mean that you're not heating. You're just not heating 100% efficiently.
Right. You're 96% efficiency.
Right. Which, like, you're still getting heat. Doesn't mean the heat shuts off. I think a lot of people kind of think
that. Do you have heat strips here or no?
We do not, no.
This house is so efficient, it has such a good envelope that your body heat, the dog, cooking, showering, provides enough auxiliary heat, plus then you've got some solar heat gain from your window package in the wintertime that you don't need when you build a really high performance house. You don't need gas to heat it.
No.
You don't need a giant boiler system. And you can also heat it, by the way, really efficiently and really low cost on your electric bill.
Yeah.
Which is blowing people's minds. The other thing I want to mention too is the old adage of heat pumps blow cold air dies hard. And so whoever buys this house, if that's an issue for them, make sure you tell them, hey, this isn't your grandfather's heat pump. At my house, my Mitsubishi system, I have this exact same system. The air is like 115 to 120 degrees of the register.
Yeah.
So it's not like the heat pump of the 70s or 80s that the air temperature coming out was 86 and that heated your house to 72 that was called for, but it felt cold to your 98.6 skin temperature up there. These are much, much hotter than the old ones. So this is a fabulous system.
Yeah, and honestly, I mean, even in construction, we had a small construction heater and kept the whole house 65 degrees.
I mean, that's pretty incredible.
It's, and
you have a 7,000 square foot house that could basically be heated with a hairdryer. It just needs that little energy
in
the wintertime.
We should see what kind of
hairdryer. I think you should try it. But you probably had a 20 amp heater down here, right?
Yeah, I don't even know if it was.
Let's call it a big hairdryer, but in effect, it's a little electric hairdryer heating the whole house because it's so airtight and it's super insulated. And by the way, don't forget about the airtightness. That's a really important detail. I think Nick was saying that we're going to be somewhere around 0.6 ACH 50 at the final. That's a really big deal. Get below one if you can. Of course, lower is better, but that makes a huge difference in your heating bill. If you had a 1.5 ACH 50 or a 2 that would still meet code, I'd be willing to bet that your calx would show double the heating load on this house.
Oh yeah, when I think about high performance, we're not going into this like we have to hit every high performance detail. We say, let's build a nice house and let's pay attention to the details. We weren't like, we need to hit a particular number, like that's our goal. Like if we don't, it's a failure. It's just, hey, let's build the best house we can. You know, it's a complicated frame. So we knew that, you know, there would be some potential inefficiencies there. And everything that we build is under one. And
amazing.
You know, we did one at 0.5, this one's 0.6. And it's just paying attention to the details. And I think, you know, anyone can implement that.
Nick, thanks for having me out, dude.
Yeah, man.
I've known this guy for more than a decade now. We probably met early 2010-ish.
Yeah.
I just started making some dorky YouTube videos. You were like, hey, I got this great podcast that's great and gaining traction. We've built great businesses, but I got to tell you, I knew from the start you were an amazing craftsman.
Appreciate that.
But what's really fun to see your evolution as a builder over the last, 15 years or so I've known you, is you really turned into an incredible high-performance builder who, by the way, also has great craftsmanship. And so you, in some respects, you've kind of flip-flopped. Like, everybody knew you as an amazing craftsman, and now you do super high performances that also have crazy high craftsmanship, and that's a huge win. We need more of that in the world. I'm really impressed with what you've done there. Way to go.
I got one more question for you.
Yeah, please.
So from the high performance, I totally respect that and I appreciate that coming from another high performance builder. But from the craftsmanship, when you walk, we've already walked the house.
But what
was the one detail that you kept looking at?
I mean, there's so many good details, but here's just a really minor one. I'm about to put a Gaggenau cooktop in my personal house, and I have some front knobs. Mm-hmm. And go upstairs, get this on B-roll. The knobs are like carved beautifully. It's like some Italian stone carver was like chipping. I'm sure that's not what it was, but chipping them out beautifully. And they're like just so gorgeous in your marble face, who puts them in the marble countertop? No one's conceived of this before. And your team did it with just excellent craftsmanship. Now, of course, the woodwork's amazing too. We could go on and on about that. But that was a detail that I was like, look, this guy's not only amazing with woodwork and plaster, but look at this stonemason work that was just, I mean, your clients are gonna show that off to their friends.
Appreciate it.
It's gonna be pretty awesome.
Guys, this property is for sale. Find out more information at 45whiteoak.com and stay tuned for the next episode.